Good afternoon. First, I would like to thank Professor Peter Flügel for having given me the opportunity to speak today. So I will speak about the treatment of series in the Ganita Sarsangraha of Mahaviracharya and its connections to Jain cosmology. The Ganita Sarsangraha is a very significant treatise on mathematics composed by Mahaviracharya, a Digambar Jain Acharya living in South India in the 9th century. We know this date with fair accuracy as the first chapter contains verses praising the king Amoghavasa. The text was discovered by Professor Rangacharya, who had chanced upon some manuscripts in the Government Oriental Manuscript Library at Madras, where he was the curator. He edited, translated, and published the text in 1912, and that edition is still authoritative today. The text has an impressive size because we have more than 1,000 stanzas divided in 9 chapters. There is one introduction and 8 subjects of treatment or practices, Vyavahar. The first, Vyavahar, deals with the operations, Parikalman. It gives procedures or algorithms and sample problems. Usually, in the Sanskrit mathematical tradition, there are 8 operations, which are these ones. But in the Ganita Sarsangraha, the first 2, addition and subtraction, are missing and are replaced by the addition and subtraction of series. So what do we mean by series? Here in the Ganita Sarsangraha, we have 2 kinds of series, which are sequences of numbers following certain law. Here you have arithmetic progression. You have to add 2 constantly, for example, here. And geometric progression, where you multiply constantly by the same number to get to the next term. The treatment of arithmetic series is not a new subject. Both Aryabhata and Brahmagupta give a few rules in their text. But in the GSS, Mahaviracharya has arranged and amplified the operations on series in a novel manner. If you see this, as we can see from this table, Mahaviracharya is the only author to start with the operation of multiplication, because the addition and subtraction are at the end. And there is no apparent explanation for this choice. In fact, in her master synthesis called Mathematics in India, Kim Plofker evokes some of the questions which are still unanswered. And she says, for example, why did Mahavir consider it possible in the Ganita Sarsangraha to dispense with addition and subtraction of numbers as canonical operations? To this question, I would add another one. Why Mahaviracharya has not only started with the multiplication, but also why he has given so much importance to these 2 operations on series? As you can see, nearly half of the first chapter is occupied by the first 6 operations, and the last 2 occupy nearly half. So if we have to work on series, we need some technical terms, and I will try to be the most clear and simple, because there will be some mathematics involved. So the terminology is like that. For the first term of the series, we take anything which means beginning, origin, source, etc. For the common difference, we have chaya, prachaya, uttara, or vridhi, anything which means increase or excess, and the number of terms is usually pada or gacha. And we have the total sum, sarvadhana. So with these 4 quantities, usually we know 3 of them, and there are some formulas which allows which allow us to find the fourth one. How, some more technical. No. Okay. Let's see the calculation of the sum, the total sum. So if we do this nowadays, we would give a formula. But at the time of the GSS, there was no algebraic notation known. So usually it's an algorithmic presentation. It goes like that. You take n, remove 1, divide by 2, multiply by r, add you the first term, and multiply by the number of terms. You will get to the sum if you do these calculations in a proper order. Or another option is to do like that. It gives exactly the same result. Some more technical terms, which are very specific, and to my knowledge, it is not used in any other mathematical text, but I may be mistaken because I didn't do a complete survey for this. So these terms are the adidana and uttaradana. So adidana is not the value of the first term only, it's the value of the accumulation of the first term. So it's u1 into n. And the uttaradana is the value of the accumulation of the common difference. Mahaviracharya is also the only author to suggest that if one change the order of the terms, the total will be the same. Last technical terms, which are very common and used by all the authors, is the last term and the middle term. So now let's see how the sample problems are presented in the manuscript. So in this manuscript, there's an exercise where you have to calculate 10 sums because you have 10 series. As you can see, the first line, there is always G for Gacha, then U for Utra, and A for Adi, and you have the numbers which are there. It seems that this presentation is always the same in all manuscripts, whatever is the region or the paper manuscript or palm leaf. Here is the palm leaf manuscript from Madras, where you have the same exercise, and in Kannada script, you have again the same formulation with the three values here. Rangacharya, in his edition, he didn't know that the presentation is always the same. And in this exercise, this is the preprint copy, which is available in Madras. You can see that he crossed the U from Uttara to put Pra, because in the text itself, it's Prachaya and not Uttara which is used. So let's do quickly an example. So we have the case here of Shravak, who offers 2 gems in the beginning and increase by 3 gems, and we have to calculate how many we get after 5, like that. So it goes like that. You calculate the beginning multiplied by the number of terms is 10, and this is the adidana. Then the number of terms minus 1 divided by 2 is 2. You multiply by the common increase, you get 6. And then you multiply by the number of terms, you get 30. This is exactly the uttaradana. And if you add both of them, you get 40. This is the total sum. Now we can also, we get sample problems where we have to find the number of terms. So the formula we would use today would be this one, but again, it will be an algorithmic presentation. How is it shown in the manuscript? You can see that when one of these three values is unknown, there is a zero which is put there because we don't know the value of the gacha, as this is the one we have to find. So, again, if we know the total sum, like 90 here, you follow the algorithm and then you multiply by 8, again by 8, etc. And you get the answer, finally. Okay, now what about geometric progressions? In fact, there is hardly any sign showing that the type of series studied has changed. Here in this palm leaf manuscript, you have a small pattern, decorative pattern, which indicates that it's, the topic has changed. In fact, it is the terminology which indicates the change, because the first term is the same, but now it's a common ratio, and it's Gunnar or Gunnatara. Again, you have Gunnadana and Gunnarsankalit for the sum of the series. How do we do to calculate the sum in the case of a geometric series? We have two formulas, which are these two on top. And in this exercise, you know that the 3 is the beginning, 5 is the common ratio, and 15 is the number of terms. So it means that you have to calculate 5 into the power of 15, which is an absolutely huge number. And to calculate this, you can obviously multiply 5 by 5 by 5 by 5, the number of times necessary, but there is a sutra which gives a procedure very similar to the one used in prosody in the Pingala text to calculate 2 to the power of n. And in the same palm leaf manuscript, in the commentary, you have that algorithm which is explained. So the number of terms is 15. So if it is even, you divide by 2. If it is uneven, you remove 1. And then you put 0. So there's a shift. You put 0, otherwise you put 1. And after, you go from down to upward, and you multiply by the common ratio. If you have 1, you multiply by 5. If you have 0, you square. And like that, in only 6 operations, you get to the answer instead of 14 multiplications if you do the other one. Now, this process is very known, and in a very famous text like the Patiganita of Sridhara or the Lilavati of Bhaskaracharya, you have the same process, but instead of writing 1 or 0, one is supposed to write multiply or square. Okay, let's now turn to the connections between this treatment of series and the gene cosmology. For that, I will look at the Tilloyopanati, which is a work written in Prakrit, a very big work, and which has plenty of numerical data and results, but also which has general procedures stated. So let's look at the most common illustrations of the loci that we have. And we will first deal with the lower region, the health. So the lower region is 7 raju high. So the raju is an uncountable unit of length. And there are 7 earths which have 1 raju each of height. And usually the illustration is this one, on this kind. But this illustration is very deceptive because it looks like the intervals between the different earths are very small. Or in fact, it should be the opposite, but it's impossible to represent. So even this illustration is deceptive, as I've indicated the thickness of every earth. So 180,000 yojana is absolutely negligible in front of one raju. So what is important is that every earth has layers, and you can see that this is an arithmetical regression because you minus 2 every time, starting from 13. Now, in these layers, the hellish souls live in huge holes, and the first earth has 30 lakhs of them, and the total of holes is 84 lakhs in the hells. So again, we get the 84 lakhs. So each layer has one central hole, Indraka, and some ordered or aligned role, Shrenibada. There are 49 in the main directions and 48 in the subdirections for the first layer, and then it's minus one every time. So the second layer, it's 48 and 47. Then you have some scattered holes also. So the aim, obviously, is to calculate how many holes you will have in any layer. So as it is an arithmetic progression, we can use the formulas. So here, if you start from the top, the first layer, there, if you add the central and aligned holes, you have 389 holes. And then you minus 8 every time you change the layer. So you can calculate, and the last one is 5. Now, in the Tiloyopanati, again, it is explained that you can also start from the bottom and say that the first term is 5 instead of being 389. If you do like that, the increase will be 8 instead of the decrease being minus 8, and that reminds the remark done by Mahaviracharya that if you change the order of terms, you get to the same formula total. So now there are also arithmetical series for each earth, and then you have to calculate the beginnings. So the beginnings are these ones, the number of holes in these layers. And here there is a formula which is stated in a general form. You can calculate the number of holes in any desired earth of level D. So D is from 1 to 7, and it has alpha layers. Again, it's a formula for calculating the sum of an arithmetic progression. But much more interesting and very specific to the Tiloyopanati is the Sutra 265, the Gatha 265, because it gives a general formula. Even if you don't know the beginning, you can still calculate the sum of the holes in the different layers of one earth. Not only the number of holes follow arithmetic progressions, but also the width of the Indrakas and the depth of the holes also are in arithmetical progression. For the width, you can notice that the first one, which is on top, is 45 lakhs, which is exactly the same as the size of the Udaidvip, the human world, the 2.5 continents. And the last one, which is the lowest one, is 1 lakh, which is exactly the size of the Jambudvip. So it's not mere coincidences. Now let's examine the cosmological structure of the middle world. It is divided into concentric rings with the Sumeru mountain at the center. And the last diameter is 1 raju. The number of rings is an asankhyat number, uncountable, and the sizes of the rings double each time. So like that, the first one is the Jambudvip, it's 1 lakh. Then the Lavana Sea is 2 lakhs, the Atacand land is 4 lakhs and 8 lakhs, then 16 lakhs yojana. Since the sizes of the rings go into geometric progression, then we can use the formulas for the geometric progression. As the common ratio is 2, so if we want the width of any ring, the formula for this is W for the width is equal to 2 to the power of n multiplied by d. D is the width of the jumbo vip. So the problem which comes, because the number of rings is uncountable. So if we want to know the width of the last C, the Swayambhu Ramana C, how do we do? Because we can't calculate 2 to the power of an uncountable number, because we don't know that number. So the how is it solved in the Tiloyapanati? There is a lot of gathas, a lot of many sutras which have been stated. For example, you can show, it requires a little bit of calculation, but it's not very difficult, that the inner diameter of a ring follows this formula. This is the middle diameter and this is the outer diameter. So knowing that the outer diameter of the middle world is 1 raju, if you know this value, then you can calculate the width of the last C. So you get this, and by doing the division by 4, you get one Jagasreni divided by 28 plus 75,000 yojana. This formula, again, in the Tiloyapanati, is specific to the situation here. It works only because the common ratio is 2. So you can get the width of a ring without knowing the diameters, wherever the inner diameter or the outer. And in the Ganitasar Sangraha, Mahavir Acharya deals with the area calculation of area of annular figure, and is the only one apart from Narayana Pandit in the 14th century. So he gives the formulas, but for this, you have to know either the inner diameter or the outer diameter. Otherwise, you can't calculate the width of the ring. But in the Tiloyapanati, because it's a specific situation, they have stated the general formula for the ring without knowing this value of diameters. So, of course, there are many more questions which can be examined in the Tiloyapanati, and many more specific results are there. But I had to make a selection. And now to conclude, I would like to say that the computation of series is a great deal of use for the description of the Jain universe. And I didn't speak about the Jambudvip itself or the heavens also, and the astral divinities. It's also a lot of series everywhere. And that there is a perfect command of the computation of series in the text on cosmology, with even some general formulas stated, just like in a mathematical text. And we have to know that Tiloyapanati is not a mathematical text, but still it's not only results which are given. The formulas, the algorithms are given also in the Tiloyapanati, and in general form. So I would like to say that the computation of series is a fundamental tool in the Jain mathematical science. So my contention is that Mahaviracharya could not but put the operation on series in the Parikarman, as it is fundamental, and also give them the importance they deserve, which explains why it occupies half of the chapter on operations. Thank you for your attention.